m sub l equals minus 1. Now, again, this goes back to some other arguments we made. Namely, this is a cyclic motion. So that's why we get quantized values. You don't get the moments at any old angle. It'll always be quantized. Because it's a cyclic motion, you'll only have particular values. This does not show up until you put a direction in the problem. Namely, if I put on a magnetic field. If I put on a magnetic field, I give this thing a direction. And then these cyclic motions are quantized around that magnetic field. Now, recall that what we're talking about is an electron going around like this. Now, an electron going around like that is like an electric current. And we said if you have an electric current and you have an area, this is an area, you have a magnetic moment, which is equal to I times the area, or actually probably cross. So what this is saying, if you have an electron in an orbit like that, it's a current going around in some kind of a loop, and it represents a magnetic moment. So this will have a magnetic property, which if I put in a magnetic field, then you'll have different energies. This state and this state and this state in a magnetic field will have different energies. So in a magnetic field, this state being parallel to the magnetic field, that's a low energy state. So it will split to here. This one will split to here, and this one, which is, this one will be a high energy state because the magnetic moment is pointing opposite to the field. It will go to here. So what you get in a magnetic field is that these will, you'll split those three states into three different energy states. In the absence of a magnetic field, these are at the same energy. There's nothing to tell the difference between upside and down. But in a magnetic field, you will get a difference. So that's why this is called a magnetic quantum number, the m sub l, is because in a magnetic field, you will see the difference among those states. I think I better stop there, because you can push the same thing up to the d states and things like that, where you'll get more, you get another s state, you'll get another p state. Well, I don't know if I can stop myself here, but if this were a d state, the n equals 3 state, what you'll get is yet another s state. And because it's the second highest state, it will come up back over the thing. It'll have two nodes. That'll be your s state. And again, it'll have a sort of a spherical angular dependence. You'll also get an additional p state. Now, the p state, this will be the second of the p states. So instead of just coming up and down, it'll cross the axis. You get one more node, because this is the second one in the l equals 1 potential. See, this potential depends on l. And if I have a different potential, but the l state will be like this. But what you'll get is a whole new series of wave functions due to the l equals 2. That's a whole different potential. There'll be a whole different potential energy. And you'll get a function that looks like that with no nodes in it. That'll be your 3s state. And then you'll have your 3p states. Oh, that's your 3p. That's your, so, oh no, this will be a 3D, I'm sorry. This is your 3S. This will be a 3P. This will be a 3D. So it's a whole new series with no nodes. And it turns out that this state has 5 possible orientations, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, corresponding to L equals 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2, which means that in a magnetic field, these states will line up. L equals 2 will line up this way. L equals 1 will have an orbit like this. L equals 0 will have an orbit like this. L equals minus 1 will have an orbit like that. And L equals minus 2 will have an orbit like that. See, it's sort of like these models here. Namely, the electron is going around. Now, this is the axis that would have the magnetic moment, because this is a current going around, and this is a magnetic moment. What this model does not show you is the fact that if this is, there are other orbits. In other words, if I could tilt this box like this without breaking something, that's a possible orbit. And this is possible. It has the same energy if there's no magnetic field. So the tilt doesn't matter until you put it in a magnetic field, and that creates the magnetic effect, which splits. So if there were a magnetic field, that orbit would be different from this orbit. See, if the magnetic field is up, that's one story. But the magnetic field, if the moment is this way, it has a different energy in that magnetic field. So that would give you your magnetic quantum numbers, which is related to the tilt of the orbit. So there's a rationale here, and there is a direct similarity between our picture of the classical orbits, the way they go. In other words, an orbit, if you look at the wave functions here, the wave function for this orbital is pretty much in this plane. The wave function for that orbital has a lot of behavior like this. It's going around this way, so the angular momentum and the magnetic moments is at an angle. And that one is even more so. Like that. So, as I say, if you squint your eyes, you can sort of imagine a particle going around, an electron going around in a Bohr-like orbit, instead of this fuzzy wave function going around. I just want to let you know that it is actually pretty rational when you figure it all out. Now, I'm afraid I'm going to run through this. I'm not going to hold you too responsible for all this fancy notation, although maybe there's a homework problem. The point is, all we're really doing here is we're giving numbers and letters to these various sort of Chladni modes, these higher oscillating modes. We call this an S mode, a P mode, a D mode, or something like that. But it's, all it is that we're trying to fit waves into this characteristic potential. There is this other feature, which is shown in this one, and that is not only does a particle go around in an orbit, Bohr-like thing, but it has another property. Namely, it can spin about its own axis. Sort of like the Earth spinning as it goes around the sun. There's one orbital this way, but also we have a 24-hour day as the thing goes around. So this motion produces a magnetic moment due to the motion of the electron, because it's a current, and has a magnetic moment, which can interact with an external field. This thing is a spinning charge. It's also a current going around. This is like an electron, some negative charge going around in a circle. So it's a current, and it has a magnetic moment. And also, in fact, the nuclei are positive charges. And they also, if they have angular momentum, they produce their own magnetic moment. And this is the one you do nuclear magnetic resonance on. Nuclear magnetic resonance means that the nucleus has a magnetic moment, which when you put it in a magnetic field, takes up an orientation. It'll prefer to be, the field is up, it'll prefer to be that way. But It has a, you know, I showed you a top, which precesses. If you put in electromagnetic energy at the frequency, I don't think it's going to fall apart when I turn it over, but if you put in that electromagnetic energy, you can get it to go from its low energy state, namely parallel, to the high energy state. You absorb energy from the magnetic, it does fall apart. If you put in energy, it goes from the low energy state to the high energy state and absorbs some energy from the field you put in, and you can tell your resonance. That's one way of doing nuclear magnetic resonance, by seeing how much energy the nucleus absorbs. But you could do also magnetic resonance on the electron, because the electron has its own magnetic moment. If you get an unpaired electron, you put that in the magnetic field. In fact, you'll even it's even easier, because the electron, being lighter, it spins faster. It has a bigger magnetic moment by a factor of 1,000. So if you have an unpaired electron, it's really a pleasure to do magnetic resonance on a spinning electron. Okay, now time has fugited. This slide here was attempting to show this story here, namely that you have, if you have a given magnetic orbital angular momentum, it can take up 2L+1 orientations. In the absence of any field in this direction, they're all the same, because it doesn't really care which way it's pointing. But if you put a magnetic field on, then it'll make a difference, and you can split these different orbits into different energies. And here you'll sometimes see pictures of the orbitals that look like this. And I just wanted to point out to you that it sort of tells you the thing. In other words, an orbital that looks like this says the electron is going around in this plane, meaning that it's going to have a magnetic moment in this direction, because this is the way the electrons are circulating. So this would be an L=1 orbital, for example. And this one, the electrons are going around in this direction, so that they will create a magnetic moment in this direction. So that'll be an L=0 orbital. Here's one where the magnetic orbital angular momentum will be pointing this way. And here you see it sort of pointing at an angle. So that is going to be L=2. This is going to be M(L=2). Here's M(L=1). Here the orbital is going around like this. They're in this direction. And this will be an M(L=0), because the thing is going around this way. The angular momentum is pointing in this direction. I throw that out to you. You just have to go home perhaps and study it. The point is now that I wanted to say something about once you have all these orbitals, you put electrons in. We have the famous rule that you can't put more than two electrons. Only one electron can have all the same quantum numbers, including the spin, this rotation of the spinning of an electron. Okay, now, if you have an atom with its energy levels, typically most of the electrons will be in the lowest energy state. And usually the gaps between the energy states are the order of electron volts, which is much, much greater than any thermal energy. So typically most of the electrons are in a state like this. So what an atom like this can do in the ground state, it can absorb energy very nicely. Because the electrons are here, you put in a photon, and you can get absorption from one level to another. If you want this thing to emit energy, what you have to do is get the electrons out of this state and into one of these upper states. By some means or other, either electrically or with light or something, you've got to get them up here. Once you get them up here, they can drop down, and then they can send out their energy. They might drop to here, and you get this much. Or they might drop all the way back down to here, in which case you'll get a higher energy thing. The way you can get a laser stands for light amplification by the stimulated emission of radiation. Actually, it's interesting to know the difference between an amplifier and an oscillator. An amplifier, like the word says, it amplifies something. You put something in, it makes it louder. Like in your radio, you have an amplifier because it picks up a little radio signal, and it amplifies it to the extent that you can hear it transform. That's an amplifier. The other thing that we have is an oscillator, with something which starts out with nothing, and it produces a radiation, an oscillator. It's self-generating of the radiation. We talked about this before, for we had an oscillator attached to an antenna in order to transmit. Now, the question is, why do they call this an amplifier? It really isn't, because you start out, here's a laser, there's no light. I'm not amplifying anything, but I turn it on, and it lights up. Let's see, is the beam here? You see, there's the laser spot on the wall. Very sharp light. So this is really not an amplifier, because I didn't put any light in to make it bigger. But I think that they call it that because if you said it was a light oscillator for stimulated emission of radiation, that wouldn't go so well. So we don't call it that. I think that's maybe why. So what it really is that what you're doing here is there's an electrical discharge in this tube, which is, by electrical means, it's shooting electrons, there's a couple of different kinds of gases in here, there's helium and neon, and it's transferring electrons. The electrons are hitting the gas atoms, they're knocking the electrons up to some state. And then the trick is, you've got to sort of accumulate electrons up in this state. And they have to sit there for a while. And then one of them drops down, emits a photon, and then it causes the other ones to emit their photons. That's what's called stimulated emission. Because one of them can fall down by itself, that's spontaneous. But once one starts, the others get the idea, and this light comes along, tickles this one, he wants to go down too, so he joins the party. He falls down. And now there are two. Then this beam comes along, it sees this other excited electron here, he joins the party, and now you have three, he's gone down, and so on. So the idea is what you do is called a population inversion. You invert the population from what it should be normally by putting more in the upper state on the upper shells, and then once it starts, the stimulated part, the light stimulates the next one to go down. So you have to pump it. In fact, you don't really make energy here. You put in more energy than you get, but the beauty part is that you've got a really nice sharp beam here, and it's also very coherent, because they stay in step. If the light reaches this atom, it's going to emit in the same step. So you get a sort of nice, strong, coherent beam made up of many photons in phase, very, very well in phase. Now, the other demo that I wanted to show you, let me spend a minute here, is the idea of tunneling. I said that waves will penetrate a barrier, but if you make the barrier thin enough, it's possible that a wave will actually live long enough through the barrier. And then if it lives, the barrier is thin enough, then maybe it'll come through with a small amplitude, namely, not very likely, it's not as much, but also it'll have the same frequency or wavelength as here, with just a few of them get through. And Okay, so let's see what this guy is doing. Here's a good old microwaves source beam, and this is just a refractive medium, and the light is being comes through here straight, hits this thing at an angle, and so it refracts. Let's see where the refracted beam went. Let me turn it up a little bit, maybe. Where are you, refracted beam? More or less here. It's coming here, and it's refracting here. By the way, this is electromagnetic. It just converted to sound so we can hear it because we can't see this wave. Okay. And the point is that there is no wave over here. Or there is. Huh. Oh, there is. Well, that's interesting. All right, let me see. Now, the question is, look, if I have this square edge here, and I put this block here, I'm making, in a sense, a square block. So at some point, when I push them together, it's one square block, and it comes through very... Sorry about that. It's coming through very strongly, because basically it's a square block, and there's no refraction at all. But the question is, it wasn't very strong before. So if I take this away, it still comes through. So what this means is, though this wave is coming through, and it wants to refract, a certain amount of it is going straight ahead. It's tunneling through this gap. See, I have a gap in here? It's tunneling through this gap and being picked up by this block. And so even when there's a real gap between them, there's still a gap. I don't know if you guys can see it. There's still a gap here. The wave is actually leaking out of this block, being picked up by this block, and then it can go straight forward. Sorry.